Hello, hello, it's Jang here with a look at the largest LEGO Ninjago set ever by just a hair. This is the final flight of Destiny's Bounty. It comes with 1,253 pieces as well as 9 minifigures. That's the most minifigs ever included in a Ninjago set as well. So this is the final hurrah for the Destiny's Bounty, which is certainly bittersweet, especially when you consider that we've only gotten two. Well, this is only the second version of it that's ever been officially produced by LEGO as a toy, and this is much more than the original version. It's more in every way. It's significantly larger, has significantly more parts. It is significantly more ornate. It has all sorts of little things all over it, just for the looks, just for the details. Things that you can interact with, things that will change, things that will do things. The dragon head on this version is brick built, completely built up, and you're able to open it up and close the jaw, so a little bit of movement there. Nice small things here, handful of stickers. These are actually compartments that can hold things. You can hold weapons and tools and such. You get two of those. They have a lock on the top. This one just has a crowbar down inside of it. This is an interesting device here, a triple stud shooter with a very simple mechanism to shoot it off. I haven't put in the individual shots there, but they do include a little crate that you can carry along in the Destiny's Bounty, which includes a bunch of shots for those stud shooters, as well as a saber and also a broom for just keeping things clean around the place. But the way this works is this is just an activator up on the top, and you push this down and it'll just hit the trigger mechanisms for each of these. You have to push it kind of hard, but all of those will end up shooting off in very rapid succession. And then moving farther down, this was very interesting to me. Once again, we've gotten this piece that is printed. There are a fair number of stickers in this set, but yet they chose to include that in this series as a printed piece, and there's one on either side. This mechanism here, this thing, is actually what controls the raising and lowering of the sails. Similar to the original version, you can affect the angles of the sails, and this is a little ratchet mechanism over here, which allows that to stop. But this is just holding these strings, which go up to this very nice printed piece. I like that quite a bit. Unfortunately, the sails are plastic and they're kind of rickety. I really don't like this. It folds and kind of holds its position where it's folded. The temperature of the air will affect how stiff this is, so when it gets warmer it starts to droop a little bit. You can see that there's just an inconsistency to the bend. I really don't like that. And you can see it's not really, none of them are really held on all that well, so they just kind of flap around. I don't like that at all. What I do like is this. It's very simple, very straightforward. So you raise them and lower them down. You see it's able to hold that. So you can actually get it to stop at different points. It doesn't have to be fully deployed. You can have it kind of right around the in-between point right there, which actually looks pretty good from a lot of angles, or you can let it down all the way. And again, these sails themselves really don't do good justice to the mechanism underneath. See for yourself, and also notice how many different types of connections are used here and how the LEGO math is made to work out. See, that's a very nice little thing. It's all parallel lines, but it's still nice. And you notice how that sail over on the right was kind of getting caught? There it goes. That's not good. It's not going down because this folded in a weird way. Again, the sails themselves, that material just really kills it. All right, moving on. Just a quick look from a slightly higher angle at the deck. There's plenty of room here on this deck to place minifigures all around there, especially if you let this go. You get tons of room out in the front there and all around the sides. So plenty of space to put minifigures on here and actually have fights and get your hands in there. I really like these lanterns because these dish pieces are not the warm gold. They're the more realistic metallic gold. Notice they put these ball joint pieces up here to get the roof to angle nicely. That's all assembled quite well. Got the little feathery look out towards the rear and a nice angle how this all comes down. That's actually a part of the roof that's able to hinge up, and we'll look inside of there in just a second. And then your engine pods over on the sides look nice, but they also have an action to them as well. To demonstrate that, I also need to show you a different feature that's built into this with a handle that just kind of hangs down. That's really what that is. It's the simplest little technique lift arm piece, but it's intended to be a handle and it actually works to some extent. It actually gives you enough control to hold this thing up. I think for smaller hands, it's not the greatest thing. You really do need to kind of brace the stern of the boat against your forearm, but it does the trick to some degree. It's a lot better than having to grab this thing around the sides. With the ship elevated, and again, clear stands not included, just regular Lego pieces that I added there so I don't have to have my hands all up in your face, you can pull back just the center section here at the rear and watch those side pods transform. It's beautiful. They don't just turn. They don't just break in two. Look at this. Goes back and then changes direction, then comes back down. Oh, that's so good to deploy the engines. Oh, I love it. That's so good just watching that happen. And it feels smooth. It doesn't feel like it's catching at any point in there. It's just a nice, smooth action. And you can see how they've got the engines that angle out in different ways, just like the real one in the show. I guess it looks pretty good directly from the rear as well. Now on that section that you pull out, you get a dual harpoon launcher, spring-loaded there. Just push these in and they do give you one extra shot as well. It's able to rotate around 360 degrees, although it's not able to angle up and down, but just a little bit of rear defense there, and you shoot these out from the sides. Where's the point? There it goes. Just kind of squeeze in and those will shoot out. I showed you how the roof could fold forward. Well, let's look into that a little bit more now. This can fold all the way open. There you can see the bridge, the control center for the ship with three consoles with the sides that are at interesting different angles, three different stickers put on there, rat and some cheese up in the rafters, and also a couple of levers for control and or operating some of the things that we've seen change and move around. Now the section of roof that I hinged up holds another nice little secret, and it's not entirely all that little. This can be pulled straight out, and it's a whole removable deployable bay. Watch this. This opens up, this comes up as well, and this is Nia's little workshop and her air bike that she can work on. Lots of tools in the metallic silver color, great to see. Bunch of circuitry stuff showing up on the top, and just a nice little extra area that you can play in. The air bike itself looks interesting, but a little bit unfinished because they did use just the standard body as well as chassis for an older style bike here. So it looks like it wants to have tires on it and wheels, and they didn't figure out anything to kind of fill up that space. But I like the stuff that they attached to it. I like the way that they attached stuff to it using the existing parts, but I just wish that it had a little bit of covering, something to kind of hide the forks and the swing arms. For protagonist minifigs, first we've got Lloyd, the green ninja over on the left, who is not possessed this time, Cole, Nia in ninja garb, and then you've got Master Wu, or Master Sensei Wu, with the staff weapon that now has the realm crystal integrated. And I like the recolor of the kind of saw or, I don't know, blade-like piece that is in Cole's weapon there. Looking at these from the back, of course, as always, a lot of stuff is hidden. Take off a bunch of the gear, now you can clearly see their torso prints all lined up very nicely. You've got a nice system going through all of them. And then, looking at them from the front again, you can now see the rest of the faces as well as hair. Yes, they include the hair as well as the hoods for each of the three characters on the left. On the antagonist side, on the far left is Moro incarnate himself, followed by Goltair, Bansha, and a Soul Archer, all with awesome weapons. I guess the archer has the least interesting weapon, but the rest of them I like quite a lot. Let's look at those from the backs as well. You see some shared parts between them. And there they are with all the extraneous stuff removed, so you can see their prints clearly, including the prints on the backs of the heads of a couple of them. Here are the prints from the front, so you can see their torso prints very clearly, as well as their very different faces. Rounding out the bad guys, on the left is a character named Spider. Yes, Spider. Very unoriginal. They did put a Y in it, though. Ooh, Spider. Yeah. And then two Screamers. Clear stands not included. They got the two different face prints that they put on the screamers here. Here's a look at these from behind. No face print on the back of Spider, and on the front there's just a more clear look at that normal face. Oh yeah, the bad guys get this too. A dragon, or as scholars of the made-up science of imaginary and fantasy animals would fervently argue, it's a wyvern, not a dragon, because it only has two legs. But in the Ninjago world, they call this a dragon anyway, so given that it's all made up, it doesn't matter. It's whatever you want to call it. But I think it looks pretty cool, and I appreciate the fact that they did go with the different design here, with just the two-legged design, because it's able to stand up and looks proper standing up. It's got the nice hands out here, because it's more of a believable kind of design, you know, kind of bird-inspired sort of thing. You can move those a little bit and you can bring them together. And it doesn't have to stay up like this. It can also be angled down to get it into more of a flight mode. So here's how we would look in flight. And these are on ball joints, the arms, and you've also got ball joints for the thighs, just the main leg. No knee in there, doesn't really need it, but you've also got these large feet for good stability. Plenty of ball joints on the very thin tail back here, and you've also got that ratcheted joint in the center. You can rotate this around. This is your main kind of your saddle, your pilot's position, and you can use these as reins, put them in the hands of a figure that is piloting this. Up forward, ball joint here, and then another one up further, and a brick-built head that looks a little bit different from the others, with the jaw extending down underneath. You've got the kind of protruding nose section that goes up, a little bit of bat influence almost here, and you can open this up. Not the best looking head. I don't know why they went with this little piece under here that's transparent. It just kind of throws off my eyes a little bit, but these are the red parts represent actual eyes on the animal. Last up is a very special treasure chest, which has within it Wu's tea kit, with just one mug there, and he's got his golden kettle and also some steam that you can put on it to make it look like it's hot. So looking at the set overall, it definitely has some good stuff about it. Great selection of figures for sure. The Destiny's Bounty looks so nice and has so many good action features to it. And the whole class, the classiness of the whole thing is just taken down unnecessarily a couple notches with those plastic sails. They're just so cheap and cheesy, and the way they fold in different ways, and it's just not good. That was a really bad decision. The dragon, or the wyvern, I feel is larger than it needs to be for a set like this, and that's a good thing. I'm happy about that. It's not the best looking animal, but I think it's good. It's got a good size, it's got the right color scheme from the theme, and it's got plenty of posability to it. So that's great, and again, the figures are great. I really like Nia in this one. It's my favorite. Certainly getting Moro and Bansha and the non-possessed version of Lloyd. But there's just something about this set that to me doesn't say must buy. I don't feel like this is the right time to have a great Destiny's Bounty set. You know, again, they put it right in the name of the set, Final Flight of the Destiny's Bounty. So why give us the big one now? Just the timing of it, the high cost of a very large set, I just don't know if it all fits into place just right for this series right now. Just my thoughts though, completely subjective. Let me know honestly what you think about this set, you know, just from your own personal perspective. Leave a comment down below, share it with the rest of the community. It's always great to see more different feedback, but I hope that I showed you everything that you wanted to see here, and as always, I hope that you'll come back to check out more of my videos, because more are on the way very soon. Catch you later.